простите. Welcome to the Glasgow Theater. This show has no intermission and please, absolutely no photo, video or audio recordings of any kind. Please to turn off all cellular telephones and surveillance devices. It's a loud show, but there are some quiet bits. And trust me, you don't want to be that person with this speech. Ladies and gentlemen, whether you like it or not, Henrik!
Hey!
You're so sweet. I do love a warm hand on my entrance. My name is Hedwig. Please welcome the Angry Inch. And my husband, Man Friday through Thursday, Yitzhak. I'm thrilled that you have joined me for the special one-time-only performance here at the beautiful Belasco Theater. Look at me on Broadway. Broadway adjacent, really. East of Broadway. Ebra. Welcome to Ebra. We are here tonight courtesy of Bob Wankel of the Schubert Organization. Indeed, on bended knee did I beg Bob for my Broadway debut. He told me not to talk with my mouth full. I'm moved, ladies and gentlemen. I'm moved by the simple fact that this cruelly abridged corpus is at this very moment being supported by the same groaning planks that cradled Brando's debut and Barrymore's farewell, where Tim Curry cracked wise, where Mark Rylance batted his eyes. Tastes like Kathy Griffin. Lesson. David Belasco built this theater in 1907. The Bishop of Broadway, they called him, since he always dressed in priestly attire. They say that if his ghost appears on your opening night, then your show would be a hit. His customary seat was in this box over here. Hello, oh hello, Clappy McGee. Oh my goodness, speaking sign language. What? Listen, can you hear me? Oh my God. That was the seat. Here's what I want. Oh, you've got it. Oh, please don't throw the dog at me. I'm good at my dressing room. Will you help me out? That was the seat that David Belasco's in. You'll keep your eye out, okay? If you happen to be touched by a priest, for God's sake, speak up. Gesture with your hands or something. Imagine us in the birthplace of awakened sin, of a raisin in the sun, and most recently, Hurt Locker the Musical. Which opened last night and closed at intermission. David Belasco. No, not David Belasco. What is his name? Bob Wankel. I forget, he was holding my ears. He told me he let me keep the stage up for one more night before they strike it. So again, Bob. Think of me as a theatrical hermit crab. Welcome to my new shell. How does it look on me? Do you like it? You legitimize me, ladies and gentlemen, you really do. But let's be honest, many of you here have only recently become aware of me. It took a tragedy to make you finally pay attention. But now you're interested, intrigued even. Who is this Hedwig? And why have we never heard about her before, Jerry? Well, that's a question I've been asking myself for years. How did some slip of a girly boy from communist East Berlin become the internationally ignored song stylist barely standing before you? That's what I want to talk about tonight. I am not here to talk about calamity or scandal. I am not here to talk about my relationship with a certain well-known rock icon, Tommy Gnosis. Even though at this very moment, he is probably talking about me. By some freak coincidence, he is launching his tour of atonement tonight in, of all places, Times Square. I shall...
There's someone else I want to thank for the way they handled this tragedy with incredible loyalty in the face of a lot of lies. And that someone is you!
Every song on that album. And BTW, TMZ got it right. He was driving, he was on blow, he was getting blown by yours truly, and he did hit that school bus full of deaf children. One survived, now blind. I told him everything he knows and has apparently forgotten about rock and roll, and yet he barely even mentions my name on that giant sucking sound Anderson Cooper calls the show, which I'm sure you all saw, because if not I would be here singing to the bishop, and if I was lucky, my manager, Phyllis Stein. Did you make it this time, Phyllis? I'm sorry. I'm wide open tonight. You are looking at a locker full of hurt. You see, ladies and gentlemen, the road is my home. My home, the road. And when I think of all the people I have come upon in my travels, I have to think about the people who have come upon me. The geography of human contact, the triangulation of a pair of eyes on my face, the latitude and longitude of a hand on my body. These are the only clues I have to my place in the world, to who I am. Who is Mystery Woman? I laugh because I will cry if I don't. I recently found my first diary, age 2 through 6, fully illustrated. And I realized that so many people have touched me on my way to the stage tonight. How can I say who touched me the most? My father? The American GI? Who left when I was barely old enough to utter my first words? Daddy, when I grow up, I'll kill you. Would it have been my East German mother? No, no. When she touched me, it was usually by accident. One day we were watching Jesus Christ Superstar on American Forces television. I turned to Mother. Jesus said the darndest things. She slapped me. Don't you ever mention that name to me again. But he died for our sins. So did Hitler.
What?
Absolute power corrupts.
Absolutely.
Better to be powerless, my son. When the war went up, her wish came true. We happened to be living on the east side, and Mother was given a job teaching sculpture to limbless children. Socialism, God rest its soul. Most of my time was spent listening to American Forces radio. Our apartment was so small that Mother made me play it in the oven. Late at night, I would rest my head on the top rack. Listen to the American masters. Tony Tennille, Debbie Boo, Anne Murray, who was actually a Canadian working in the American idiom. And then there were the crypto homo rockers. Lou Reed, Iggy Pop, David Bowie, who was actually an idiom working in America and Canada. These artists left as deep an impression on me as that oven rack did on my face. To be a young American in muskrat love, soft as an easy chair, not even the chair. I am, I said, have I never been mellow? Never tried. And the colored girls sing. I sang alone. Never with the melody. How could I do it better than talking to Lou? Once I could not resist singing the lead. It can't be wrong when it feels so right. Mother threw a tomato at my head. But I was quite content to sing gentle backup harmonies in my oven while Mother sculpted in the shower. When the hour grew grew late and it was time for bed, she would shout from the bathroom, "Well, that's me!" And I would reply from the kitchen, "Well, I guess that's me too." We would wash our feet and brush our teeth and lie down on the narrow pallet that we had shared since Daddy left. Like two pieces of a puzzle that don't quite fit but are jammed together and left on a table by some dangerous shut-in with too much time on his hands. I'm sorry, I'm completely dilated right now. I would like to share with you a bedtime story that Mother once whispered to me in the dark and later retracted. Whatever allowed her to reveal such a story to such a little boy, I'll never know. But I remember it like it happened yesterday. Still flat, and clouds made of fire, and mountains stretched up to the sky, sometimes higher. Folks roamed the earth like big Roman heads. They had two sets of arms, they had two sets of legs, they had two faces peering out of one giant head, so they could watch all around them as they talked while they read, and they never knew nothing of life. It was before the origin of life. Grew quite scared of our strength and defiance, and Thor said, "I'm gonna kill them all with my hammer, like I killed the giants." But Zeus said, "No, you better let me use my lightning like scissors, like I cut the legs off the whales, dinosaurs into lizards." And then he grabbed up some boots, he let out a laugh, said, "I'll split them right down the middle, gonna cut them right." I could not recognize, 'cause you had blood in your face. I had I do love a good scrim job. After Mother finished her story, she began to snore. But I had to go somewhere I could think. I crept into the kitchen, put my head in the oven. It is clear that I must find my other half. But is it a he or a she? Is it Daddy? He went away. Or Mother? I was suddenly afraid to go back to bed. What does this person look like? Identical to me or somehow complimentary? Does my other half have what I don't? Did he get the looks, the luck, the love? Were we really separated forcibly, or did he just run off with the good stuff? Or did I? Will this person embarrass me? And what about sex? Is that how we put ourselves back together again? Is that what Daddy was trying to do when he... Or can two people actually become one again? And if we're driving on the Autobahn when it happens, can we still use the diamond lane? Practical questions, ladies and gentlemen, of wholeness, completion. Think of it, I thought of it, I thought of the power. The gods would be terrified.
Das muss man ändern!
Look, it's on immigration! If you behave, I might let you shave my back. That will be all. Sorry you had to see that, ladies and gentlemen. When I met him, he said he wanted to be a model. A foot model, maybe. You're late. You're late. It's so less funny when you're late. It's not difficult. Watch my legs. How do you like my hair? Do you love it? It's long, it's luxurious. Like younger Tara Reid. It smells heavenly too. It smells like the hands of 75 Bangladeshi children. Too soon? Too late. I realized there was only one person who had ever really been there for me in my life. And that person was me. The accident was a cry for help. I was yelling help. Me.
But what about me? Without me, he never would have swerved into that oncoming short bus and revived his moribund career with a well-timed redemption tale. Gag order be damned. It all went down in the newly annoying meatpacking district. Meepaw. I had just been dismissed, banned really, from the chain hotel. You've heard of it. Apparently I had left my douche ID at home. Limbo pulled up. I hopped in, naturally mistaking it for my own.
Yeah, right.
Say it to my face. I will stab you with my heel. Inside the limo sat Tommy Gnosis. We were both astonished. It had been years, so we dropped the driver off and we drove up and down the island doing drugs and catching up. We talked about the disappointing sales of his sophomore album, the one he wrote without me. He spoke of his loneliness. I reminded him of happier days. I just couldn't keep my mouth shut and, well, you know the rest. So you can imagine when the story broke, Tommy's people offered me a small fortune to keep all of this to myself. As if I would accept their filthy lucre. As if selling the story of someone else's pain was my only means of support. As if I hadn't already launched my new fragrance, Atrocity by Hedwig. It's a fragrance for a man or a woman. Or a man-woman. Or a woman-man, or a woman, or a wear. I digress. One day, in the late mid-80s, I was in my early late 20s. I had just been dismissed from university after delivering a brilliant lecture on the aggressive influence of German philosophy on rock and roll, entitled You Can't Always Get What You Want. But if you try sometimes, you just might find you get what you need to. At 26, my academic career was over. I had never kissed a boy, and I was still sleeping with Mom. The search for my other half on this side of the world had proved futile. Might he be found on the other? But how to get over? People died trying. Such were the thoughts flooding my tiny head on the day that I was sunning myself in an old bomb crater I had discovered near the wall. I am naked, lying face down on a piece of broken church, inhaling a fragrant westerly breeze. The new McDonald's had just opened up on the other side. All I seem to get is the unhappy meal. And I'm not loving it. The sun is hot, but I feel a sudden chill. I look over my shoulder. A head-shaped shadow is resting on the pillow of my ass. Girl, I sure don't mean to annoy you, but my name is Sergeant Luther Robinson. I turn my body to face him. My name is Hunter. Luther is silent for a moment as he stares at my little bishop in a turtleneck. Hunter, well, I bet you like candy. I like gummy bears. Out of his pocket comes a strange, American-looking packet that says gummy bears on it. Gummy bears, I know. I select a single clear bear. It is the biggest one I've ever seen. The taste is completely different from a gummy bear, yet somehow familiar. It's much sweeter than a gummy bear, and softer too. Its little gummy body stretches on the rack of my molars. Wow. I feel so optimistic. He pours me a handful, his eyes heavy with an unfamiliar desire. Would it be a desire to please me? I suddenly recognize the flavor in my mouth. It is the taste of power. Not bad. Damn, Hansel, I can't believe you're not a girl. You're so fine. Why don't you take the whole bag? He stares at my face for news of his fate. His expression is echoed in scores of tiny faces pressing against clear plastic. Panting faces of every imaginable color, creed, and non-Aryan origin. Fogging up the bag like the windows of a Polish bathhouse. It's only a shower. Absolute power. I push Luther away, and I stumble naked through the ruins back toward blander, less complicated confections, leaving in my wake a trail of rainbow carnage. Next day, Hansel follows the trail back, and lying on my slab are three Milky Ways, a roll of Necco wafers, some Pop Rocks, and a giant-sized sugar daddy named Luther. For licorice drops and jelly rolls. Hey, sugar daddy, Hansel needs. My mother's camisole.
Can I have a B flat?
Oh, don't worry, you'll be flat.
We found a sanctuary in the hurt locker, a spot of safety on the roads. Love can be scary in the hurt locker. It's tender and it's raw. We're filled with shock and awe, and we will be consumed when love explodes.
I'm sure it's better in Farsi.
We will be consumed when love explodes.
Oh, that'll be enough of that. That'll be enough of that. Thank you very much. That was boring. What was I talking about? Oh, I remember. Louvre and I got married. But it wasn't a traditional wedding. For example, when Luther popped the question, I was on my knees. And there we go. I want a cigarette. Do you mind? I'm going to have a quick smoke. Take this. Stop singing. Oh, this is ID. Thank you. I was suddenly the happiest boy in the world. The man I loved was going to take me away to the land I had only dreamed of. The land of the free and the home of me. The real. Next day, I invite Luther over for dinner. After dessert, he produces a ring, an application for American citizenship, and a wig. He loves me, Mother. He wants to marry me and get me the hell out of here. I put the wig on my head. It is a hideous beige shag. Mother, is this plan so crazy that it just might work? Mother's face might have been a photograph, it was so still. After what seemed like a lifetime, probably hers, she reaches out her hand to straighten the wig. Get me my camera and my passport, Hansel. I know a certain party. It's a simple cut and paste job. We change the photo and you can use my name, Hedwig Schmidt.
Not so simple, ladies. Baby. You know I love you. I'm always thinking of you, but I gotta marry you here in East Berlin. And that means a full physical examination.
I then see right away that...
Baby, to walk away, you gotta leave something behind. Am I right, Mrs. Schmidt?
I've always thought so, Luther. Hansel, to be free, one must give up a little part of oneself. And I know just the doctor to take it. Don't move!
Go!
Yeah.
November 9, 1988. A tiny registrar's office with a breathtaking view over the wall. Herr Hanser Schmidt becomes Mrs. Hedwig Robinson. Tomorrow, I am leaving on a jet plane. And by the time I get to Phoenix, love will keep us together. Because I'm just an embryo with a long, long way to go. But I know too much to go back and pretend. November 9, 1989. Junction City, Kansas. I sit in my mobile home and on bootleg cable watch the wall come down. Divorced, penniless, a woman. I cry because I will laugh if I don't. I suddenly miss mother. I consider phoning Berlin, but then remember with envy her recent escape to sunny Yugoslavia. Perhaps Luther would pick up. No, no. It had only been 1 month since he ran off with that bag boy he met on ChristianMingle.com. Whatever we called it back then. Church. What am I doing? He was never the one, never the missing half. I catch myself in a mirror. And for the first time see clearly the horror hunkering on my head. The same carpet remnant that Luther presented me 1 year ago to disguise my receding. I'm receding. I tear the wig from my scalp and I hurl it across the room towards a pile of unopened anniversary presents. And there it lies, feigning shock. My personal hair system. My personal hell. My head wig.
Some curves that I would not choose.
gin and tonic. And I want you to read the lyrics that we've written above. Just follow the bouncing balls.
I put on some makeup, lovely. Turn up the 8-track.
What's an 8-track?
I'm pulling my weight down from the shelf.
Queen. I can't feel the love tonight.
Anything, crazy dog lady? Something with the comedy.
I was kidding about the house.
All right, on three. Ready?
Oh, no, please. Sit down. Someone stop this horrible moment.
who needs a dead man's approval? We're on our roll tonight. You're having fun, yes? Yes?
That was a rock and roll gesture. Actually, that was more of a heavy metal gesture. Notice the punk rock gesture? The direction of the aggression that defines it.
How about this band? Aren't they wonderful? On bass, Datsik. On drum, Trako. On guitar, Krzysztof. Ed, my trusted musical director. Skishup.
Say it, Skishup. What is it?
Skishup.
One more time for me. I feel like I'm saying the exact same thing as you. I'd like to buy you a vowel. All so very talented and all so very lucky to be in this country, isn't that right, boys?
Yes,
very good, boys. Well, oh, thank you. Just what I need on a sweaty stage. Do you like my jacket?
When some bitch stopped me on the way in.
Excuse me. What poor, unfortunate creature had to die for you to wear that?
My Aunt Trudy, I replied.
Oh, I didn't introduce my husband, Yitzhak. I'm sorry, Yitzhak, everyone.
We met on my last Croatian tour. He was the most famous drag queen in Zagreb. My manager, Phyllis Stein, thought he would make a great opening act. Billed as the last Jewess in the Balkans, he lip-synced something from Yentl under the name Kristallnacht.
Oh, good. He was too good. His applause drowned out my introduction. I refused to go on. But on my way out, he stopped me and begged me to take him with me. My face might have been my mother's, it was so still. I said to him, Kristen, to walk away, you got to leave something behind. I'll marry you on the condition that a wig never touch your head again. He agreed, and we have been inseparable ever since and will continue to be, isn't that right, honey? Eeyah. Look, it's like immigration. Barbra Streisand. What no fun, go back to your hole. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you are becoming fans of Hedwig, because I find that I am growing deeply accustomed to you.
One day, this little trailer trash kid put on some of his mom's eyeliner, grabbed his beat up JC Penney guitar, and called himself Tommy Yosis.
Tommy, can you hear me? From this milkless tit, you suck the very business we call show.
Okay. Okay. You want to know about Tommy Yosis? I will tell you about Tommy Yosis. Get this dead thing off of me. Danke. After my divorce, I scraped by for many years with babysitting gigs and odd jobs, mostly the jobs we call blow. I had lost my job at the Bass PX and I had lost my gag reflex. You do the math. I sat for the baby of General Speck, commander of the nearby army fort. His other son was the artist formerly known as my butt boy, Tommy Speck. Tommy was at the time a 17-year-old, four-eyed, pockmarked, Dungeons and Dragons obsessed Jesus freak with a fish on his truck, and I found him incredibly hot. Perhaps it was his disdain for authority, his struggle with organized religion. One day, I walked in on him punishing the bishop. He was in the bath, with the door wide open, clearly waiting for me. I reached down, finished his grace off, and dropped a flyer in the water. By the way, Tommy, I'm performing a short set tonight at Dr. Espresso's Seattle-style coffee enema bar. Maybe I'll see you there. You see, I had recently returned to my first love, music. I had tried singing once back in Berlin, they threw tomatoes. After the show, I had a nice set. But newly motivated, I bought a cheap electric piano. I found a couple Korean sergeant's wives to churn out a mean rhythm section. And we became quite the draw, singing the hits of the day under the name The Angry Inch. That night, the audience was small, but hostile. Thank you. Thank you. That was another one by Creed. On the guitar. Give it up. Give it up, Quen. We seem to have a celebrity here tonight over by the Sweet and Low. Ladies and gentlemen, little Tommy Speck, the general's son. That's more than I got, honey. He's embarrassed. Don't be embarrassed. Come here. I must admit I'm a little nervous myself. This is the first song I've ever written. And it's written for a guy to sing. We're talking to John Mayer's people. But then again, aren't we all? cost you all I fear. The pious, hateful, and devout, you're turning tricks till you're turned out. The wind so cold it burns, you're burning out and low round. And if you've got no other choice, you know you can follow my voice through the dark turns and noise of this wicked little town.
Shroud of Hedwig. Fight for it. The next day I was putting the little speck baby to bed when Tommy is at the door with an expensive looking electric guitar.
Your show. That song. My dad got me this guitar to apologize for being a pathetic little dictator. You want to come up to my room?
We went up to the attic, and he sang me songs.
Classics.
I was informed. The bands were new to me. Boston, Kansas, America, Europe, Asia. I put my hand on his strings. Travel exhausts me.
Where are you from, Edward?
I told him my story. His face might have been a Yes album cover. It was so still.
Have you accepted Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as your personal savior?
No, but I love his work.
You know, what he saved us from was his fucking father. I mean, what kind of God creates Adam in his own image, pulls Eve out of him to keep him company, and then tells them not to eat from the tree of knowledge? That was so micromanaging. So was Adam. But Eve. Eve just wanted to know shit. She took one bite of the apple, and then she found out what was good and what was evil, and then she gave it to Adam so that he would know because they were in love, and that was good. They now knew. Hedwig, will you give me the apple? The words spilling from those lips, and his eyes, his irises, were clear cylinders of surprising depth and emptiness. Only a few puddles of bluish pain sloshed around inside. Same blue as my eyes. At the time, Tommy's performance options were limited to the occasional guitar mass. I initiated a 6-month curriculum of rock history, lyrics, grooming, and vocal training, my patented oven technique.
graduation, I gave him his name, Tommy Gnosis, the Greek word for knowledge. We collaborated. Songs exploded out of us. He started singing backup for me at Dr. Espresso's. Teenage girls started showing up. We added a few duets, standing room only. Then the Sizzler called. Had the Sizzler ever called anyone before? Next thing you knew, we were in the middle of a year-long residency next to the salad bar. In a matter of months, we were outgrossing monster trucks in Wichita. With that kind of money pouring in, I could give up all of my other jobs and devote myself entirely to our career. We were very happy. One day, I am curled up in my trailer, enjoying my usual late afternoon constitutional of grain, alcohol, and Brita. I like to be good to myself. Suddenly, Tommy is at the door in tears. Honey, what is it? My dad, and my mom, and my parents. I hold him as I had never been held. But as usual, he squirms, slides behind me, and clutches my spine to his chest. I am suddenly very much aware that we have not kissed in all of the months we've been together. In fact, he has maintained a near perfect ignorance of the front of me. Honey, why don't you work on that new song while I finish shaving your eyebrows? Look what you done. Another song blows in from the trailer next door. This song has been playing on a loop for 3 days. Tommy looks up at me through new lenses, one blue and one pink. What do you think? Does love last forever? No, but this song does. Do not knock a multi-platinum single. I wish I could hit those notes. Just move your lips and I'll sing them for you, honey. From a shadowy corner of the stage. Like Mick Jagger's backup singer. We laugh at the professional reference and I return to his brows. Seriously, Tom? Yes, I believe love is immortal. Look what you've done. God damn it. How is it immortal? Well, perhaps because sometimes love creates something that was not there before.
What, like procreation?
Yes, but not only.
What, like recreation?
He grabs my ass and he laughs. I don't. Sometimes, just creation. Don't move. I paint a bold silver cross on his forehead. Honey, have you thought of a D after that E flat? And draws the curtains which are attached at the top and the bottom. He reaches out his hand. I take it and I am filled with an ancient clarity. He's the one. No blood in my eyes. No blood on his face. He's the one who was taken. The one who left, the twin, born by fission. He'll die in fusion. Our fusion, cold fusion, unlimited power, unlimited knowledge, the secrets he must hold, the memories that we shared, the words to complete the sentence I began, I am. My eyes fill with muddy Maybelline tears.
Oh, Hedwig. Oh, God.
When Eve was still inside Adam, they were in paradise.
When she was pulled from him, that's when paradise was lost. So when she enters him again, paradise will be regained. However you want it, honey, just kiss me while we do it. I wrench his body towards mine and I thrust his hand between my legs. What is that? That is what I have to work with. My mom is probably wondering what you fucking sissy. What are you afraid of? I love you, but then love the front of me! He runs out the back door.
Thank you.
nice over here. Out of the spotlight. Singing backup harmonies in my oven. You were good, thank you. They seem to like you. Perhaps there is room enough for both of us in this art. I can see it now. The German and the Jew. Imagine the symmetry. Imagine the publicity. Imagine the power, the God.
Oh.
sing a song that someone wrote for me a long time ago. I don't know where she is tonight, but if you're real quiet, maybe she can hear me.